There's another school of thought that claims that something survives, some kind of energy, some spirit. And that energy, that spirit, can manifest itself in the form of a ghost. With me between now and nine, a man who for most of his life has been fascinated by ghosts, ghosts of all kinds, ghosts of all descriptions. And if he hears of a ghost, he'll investigate it. President of the Ghost Club, Peter Underwood. Good evening.
Good evening.
What is a ghost? Is it possible to give one definition?
No, I don't think it is. I think there are, as you said, many different kinds of ghosts, and certainly from every part of the world, in every civilization, there have been reports of ghosts and ghostly happenings, and there really is too much evidence for it all to be imagination. I'm not sure that they are evidence of an afterlife. They very, very rarely show any... seem to have any idea of the presence of human beings.
So if they're not evidence of an afterlife, what are they?
Well, I think it's more likely that they are some image that in some way which we don't understand is transmitted onto the atmosphere under certain climatic or traumatic conditions.
So scientific freaks, really, more than...
Yes, I think they're a natural... Day. Yes, they're a natural phenomenon which we don't yet understand.
Reading your book, The Ghost Hunter's Guide, I'm surprised to discover just how many kinds of ghosts there are. What are the most common ones?
I suppose the commonest are the historical and the poltergeists. Almost any of the large houses that are open to the public these days, if you ask the guides whether they have a ghost, they very often say, oh, there's a green lady who walks along the corridor or something, equally unlikely. But nevertheless, quite often there are interesting stories associated with these old houses that in fact incorporate her. I mean, a typical example would be of I looked into the house at Bram's Hill, which is now a police college, and there's a famous ghost there. But while I was there, someone said, have you heard about the Green Man? And I said, no, I thought I'd heard just about every type of ghost there was. But they said, oh, there's a Green Man without legs who always appears near water. And I thought this was just about a little bit over the top. But while I was going through the records at Bram's Hill, looking for evidence of the famous white lady there, I came across an eccentric Cope ancestors. The Cope family lived there for many years. And in the 1860s, he was hung up on the colour green. He used to eat nothing but green. He used to paint his house green. He dressed from head to foot in green, except that in the 1860s there were no such things as green Wellington boots, and so he had to wear black Wellington boots. And I suppose at a distance, if you saw somebody dressed except for the feet or legs, you'd think they hadn't got any legs. And he always appeared near water, and this particular eccentric Cope ancestor committed suicide by drowning himself.
It does seem that many famous ghosts have in their corporal life met with a really sticky end, a nasty end. They've been put to death or they've been murdered or whatever.
That's right, yes. Of course, the interesting thing is that there are a great many violent deaths in this world of ours, with murders and suicides and so on, accidents and so on, and the vast number of these just take place and nothing happens afterwards. But just very occasionally, a traumatic or violent happening seems to leave some kind of impression on the atmosphere, which reoccurs. And these are the type of ghosts that are always seen in one particular place doing one particular thing.
It's nothing to do with their souls being in torment and them trying to free themselves in some way by coming back.
Well, that is the spiritualist hypothesis, but I have to say there's no evidence of that. I mean, if you say that the ghost is the spirit of the person, then you get into very difficult areas. When, for example, say Anne Boleyn, you say that the spirit of Anne Boleyn haunts the tower where she was executed, and it haunts Sarratt Church where she was buried, and it haunts Blickling where she was happy as a child, it doesn't really make sense. But if you say that when a traumatic happening, either happy or unhappy, occasionally leaves something behind, then it is possible that when she was happy at Blickling, something of that remains behind.
In many cases, someone who sees a ghost perfectly genuinely to them is seeing something no one else would because of their own personal emotions or something going through their heads.
Yes, I think that it is true to say that well over 90% of reported ghosts have no objective reality outside the minds of those who see them.
Are the people who see them then in some way mentally disturbed?
Well, I wouldn't say mentally disturbed. It's simply that their imagination and their the way their brain works. When you see two or three dark spots on a light background, it is your mental mind. It simply automatically makes a face out of it. And if you're in that sort of
receptive
mood, yes, you will.
In popular fiction, ghosts are invariably evil. Are they in reality? Are the majority of ghosts evil, wicked, nasty things?
No, I don't think they are. But then you see, it's the same with exorcisms. People try and have exorcisms. I've attended about 8 exorcisms, and none of them had any lasting value. But then an exorcism presupposes that the power of good is going to be paramount over the power of evil. I don't think there's anything evil about ghosts. They're simply there, and if you're in the right place at the right time, you'll see them.
Well, some of them do terrible things, don't they? They make a habit out of frightening people.
Well, if you feel that, yes. That is the only way that the ghosts have ever hurt anyone, by frightening them. And it's not really the ghosts, is it? It's the person who's frightened of the dark or frightened of something they see.
We'll be talking about how your fascination with the paranormal started in a few minutes, but let's hear your first musical choice this evening, Fats Waller's Honeysuckle Rose. Why this?
Well, it's simply that it's a memory. Just before the last war, I used to come up to London with my brother, who was very keen on music hall, and I remember we used to go to the old Home and Empire, and there were wonderful bills in those days of Fats Waller and Gracie Fields and Nat Gonella and Max Miller, and I remember seeing Fats Waller and him playing this tune, and I've always remembered it.
Goodness knows, honeysuckle rose. Don't buy sugar, you just have to touch my cup. You're my sugar, it's sweet when you stir it up. When I'm taking sips from your tasty lips, the honey valley drips. Your confection, goodness knows, honeysuckle rose.
Waller, Honeysuckle Rose. That's Peter Underwood's first musical choice this evening on LBC. We'll be talking again in a moment.
For the next few days,
LBC, I'm talking to the president of the Ghost Club, Peter Underwood. When did your fascination start with the paranormal? Was it in childhood?
Well, yes, it was. It so happened that my grandparents lived in a haunted house, and my grandparents were farming people, and the farm, of course, was a great attraction to me as a boy, and I used to spend a lot of my summer holidays with my grandparents. They farmed at Rosehall near Rickmansworth in Hertfordshire, and Rosehall was reputed to be haunted. I can well remember staying with my grandparents, be it 9 or 10 perhaps, and people would come to the door and ask whether they could see the haunted room and hear the ghost story, because the ghost story was published in a book with the name of the house which was published. Very briefly, the story was that a traveller was on his way north when the storm became so bad that he decided to try and put up for the night, and he went to the nearest large house which he could see, which happened to be Rosehall, and they welcomed him in, showed him into a room where there was a large four-poster bed, and during the night he saw this figure which other people had previously seen. And I can remember my grandmother seeing someone walking up the path, a stranger. Incidentally, my grandmother used to say that she'd had 8 children and been up at all hours of the day and night, never seen anything worse than herself. But she'd see this stranger and she'd say, "Here's somebody else, Peter, show them the room and tell them the story and get rid of them," which I did.
Did you ever see anything yourself?
Nothing at all. No, nor did they. No, my grandparents. But I would show the room and tell the story to these people, and very much tongue-in-cheek, you know, that real grown-up people could believe this sort of thing. But very often, by the time I'd finished, they'd say, "Well, we're not surprised, you know, because we've got a ghost." And as I grew older, I began to think that perhaps there was a little bit more in this than I'd at first thought.
Yes, I mean, children traditionally love being scared witless
That's
by
right.
things that go bump in the night, but it doesn't often sustain into adulthood. Why was that the case with you, that it did, this fascination?
Well, I don't know, except that, as I say, I had this experience of when I was very young, and so always my mind was open to the possibility that there were such things. And as I grew older, I just simply became more and more interested, because at a very early age, it seemed to me that some people did have these experiences.
How did you pursue it when you were, say, going through school, college, university, whatever? How did you actually think about pursuing it as a career, if you did then?
Well, no, I didn't. No. It was always a sort of hobby, a sort of sideline. I was always interested in writing, always wanted to be a writer, and but I was always interested in this possibility, which is one of those things, I mean, everyone has some sort of interest. I was always interested in the paranormal, and as I grew older, I joined the various organisations and societies, and it's gone on from there, really.
And the Ghost Club, which you're now president of, was founded in 1862, at
That's
a time
right.
when the whole subject wasn't perhaps taken as seriously as it is now. There were a lot of charlatans around out to make a quick quid
well,
out of it.
That's right, yes. And indeed, the Ghost Club was originally founded for the express purpose of exposing those sort of people. The idea was that a group of London business and educated people, headmaster and so on, got together and decided to try and see whether there was anything in the cult of spiritualism which was beginning to sweep the country from America. And they exposed quite a lot of mediums.
What were their motives?
Purely to see whether there was anything in this spiritualism.
It wasn't a kind of vendetta against...
Oh, no. People. No, it's purely... I mean, some they said that this is genuine, and but it sort of grew from there, and there are sceptics and believers, if you like, in the Ghost Club today.
Compared to when the Ghost Club started, 124 years ago, how have public attitudes changed towards the existence, possibly, of ghosts?
Well, I have to say that I don't remember the attitude 100...
No, I'm not asking you for a first-hand account.
But, yes, I would say, looking at the records, that we are rather more sceptical now than they were in those days.
We are? That surprises me. I
yes.
would have thought it would be
oh,
less.
Yes. No, we are more sceptical. The... in those days, if there was a ghost story, everyone sort of hurried off and explored it and looked into it. But nowadays, if we hear about a ghost, we make a number of very careful inquiries before we do anything, because there are an awful lot of people who are only too pleased to put one over on investigators and people who are interested in this sort of subject.
I would imagine the majority of public attitudes towards ghosts are shaped by the fiction they read. Most of us
yes,
have never had any real experiences. We
no.
read fiction, though. We read, say, the work of M.R. James, who
yes.
was possibly the great ghost writer.
Yes.
Has that been a hindrance, the way that it's put across in fiction?
Well, not altogether, I think. I mean, I think you have to appreciate that if you go into this seriously, there is a great difference between the ghost of fact and the ghost of fiction. The wispy, transparent figure with cannonballs around its ankle and its head under its arm is strictly the ghost of fiction. The real ghost, the true ghost, if there are such things, appear to be absolutely normal. They appear to be solid, they act quite naturally, and there's nothing frightening about them. 9 times out of 10 people that see ghosts aren't frightened, because very often they don't realise that they are ghosts until afterwards. They see something and then realize that I've done myself.
But there's a couple of examples in your book of people who have seen ghosts, and although they do look solid, and although you can't see through them and so on, they know immediately for some reason that they are ghosts.
Mm.
What do they give out that makes people...
I don't know. I mean, some people do apparently have this sixth sense, perhaps. I just don't know.
Well, when there is a ghost in your presence, are there common manifestations apart from the actual presence of this object? The room goes cold quite often, for instance, I think.
There is always a coldness about, yes. But then, I mean, if it's outside, one you know, doesn't realise that this is anything unusual. And even suddenly feeling cold in a house, you see a figure, if a certain person sees a figure, or one may feel it's suddenly cold, it doesn't always associate it with a ghost.
Coldness, of course, very much associated with death.
Oh, yes, and it's also associated, interestingly enough, with the spiritualism. I mean, I'm not a spiritualist, but we're interested in some of the phenomena that spiritualists produce. And in the seance room, when the spiritualists, genuine spiritualists, produce phenomena, there too the temperature goes down.
Is there any explanation for that at all?
Well, I don't know, except that in practically every haunted house there is a cold spot, or a part that is colder than any other part of the house. And it may be in some way which we don't understand. Energy is withdrawn from the atmosphere in these places, because energy is employed. I mean, objects do move, and where the energy is stored is a great problem. We don't know.
So you don't think that when, say, people die, they retain some kind of energy? All the energy goes when the body goes?
I don't know.
And they have to get it from elsewhere?
I would think so. I don't know. See, we don't know. We don't understand the circumstances under which these figures appear. That they do appear is absolutely undeniable. There's far too much evidence. But the circumstances under which they appear vary. We draw up scores and scores of graphs and details of every circumstances under which these figures are seen. And we think, this is it. And then we find one which is entirely different.
And only 10%, you were saying, really are ghosts that could be seen by all, by everybody.
Yes, it's very difficult to put a figure. I often put it higher than that. But the thing is that we get an enormous number of reports of ghosts which turn out, vast majority, turn out to be the result of malobservation, conscious fraud even, but usually malobservation and wishful thinking.
Isn't it a bit frustrating, spending as much time as you do ghost hunting, when 90% turn out not to be real?
Well, I think the thing that is important is that if you discover one that is absolutely concrete, if you discover one that cannot be denied, then it's really worthwhile. I mean, if the scientific world obviously is interested only in a repeatable experiment, we aren't able to produce that yet. But one day, perhaps, we shall discover every circumstance that is necessary for the production of a ghost, and then we can produce a repeatable experiment.
As you collect more and more evidence, which you say is irrefutable, has the scientific world begun to come more around to your way of thinking?
Yes, there are already quite a number of scientists who are willing to accept that there is something out there. But there is a natural reluctance, because if it is established that is so, then the whole scientific idea of the concept of universe and...
So they'd be cutting their own throats if they admitted
exactly,
it.
Exactly, yeah.
The role of the Ghost Club, since it started, it started off to investigate the paranormal, and also, in doing so, exposing the charlatans. How has that role changed over the years? Is it still the same basic motives?
To an extent, but it is now more of a club, more of a social club. It is essentially a club, not an organisation. I mean, the Society for Psychical Research has taken over, perhaps, the being the official organ in Britain where these things are looked into. And the Ghost Club is, in a way, a social club combined with an investigating society. I'm not sure it's altered all that much, but I think it's true to say that the Society for Psychical Research now occupies the position that the Ghost Club started.
And what kind of people are its members? Are they from all walks of life?
All walks of life, yes. All walks of life. Doctors, scientists, clergymen.
They have to be qualified in some relevant way, then?
No. Normally, membership is by invitation only. And one has to be recommended by an existing member, as is the normal way of many London clubs. We don't ask our members to subscribe to any religion, belief, opinion, but at the same time we feel that they should reach a certain criteria which we put for each particular member.
Can you be religious, whatever kind of religion it is, and believe in ghosts, or do the two contradict each other?
I don't think so, no. Certainly we have people who are religious, and even we have even Roman Catholics who are members.
Let's hear your second musical choice this evening. Stefan Grappelli and Yehudi Menuhin, Love Is Here to Stay.
Yes, Yehudi Menuhin, I'm not able to play any sort of musical instrument, and I've always
had
a great admiration for people who can play, and particularly the violin, which seems to me a very beautiful instrument. And Yehudi Menuhin, I think, is an absolutely marvellous player. And Stephen Grappelli, I can remember his Hot Club of France days, and to hear the two playing together, for me, is perfection.
Thank you.
Stefan Grappelli and Yehudi Menuhin performing Love Is Here to Stay, Peter Underwood's second musical choice this evening. We'll be talking again on LBC after the news and sport.
Oh,
Peter Underwood, your new book, The Ghost Hunter's Guide, is it aimed at people with no experience, no former knowledge, who want to become paranormal detectives? Is it a starter book?
Well, it is a starter book, and it's also for people who have had some experience. There are an awful lot of people, I find, who write to me and say they're very interested in ghosts, they've become interested and they'd like to go ghost hunting. What should they take with them, what should they do? And that really is the purpose that I wrote the book. It tells you how to go about ghost hunting in a proper scientific way, so that if you do come across anything, hopefully you will record it in a way in which it will be accepted by people like the Society and the Ghost Club.
You don't just write about ghosts, do you? I mean, your list of titles is, you're a prolific writer. I mean, you've written, well, The Life of Danny LaRue, for instance.
Well, yes, I'm a full-time writer. I'm not only write on, but this is a particular interest of mine. The Life of Danny LaRue, it's simply that I wrote a biography of Boris Karloff, the horror actor, who is a remarkable man, and the publishers of that book, when it came out, they were very pleased with the success of it, and they said, oh, we must do another show business personality, and I couldn't think of anyone, and they came up with Danny LaRue, and I wasn't terribly keen on the idea, to tell you the truth, but my son-in-law had an uncle who used to work with Danny LaRue, and he said, oh, he's an awfully nice chap, you know, come and see me, and we went and had a day with his uncle. And I came away and I felt that, you know, this was something worth doing. It had never been done before, and although Danny wasn't very happy with it, I don't think, or didn't help at all. But then, I mean, he's getting to the time when, you know, you can dress up as a woman so long, and then it becomes silly. And he's almost reached that age, I think, without being unkind. And I think he was going to spend the last few years of his, what he was doing, writing his own life story, and so I rather cut the grass around his feet. Yeah, and I wasn't very keen on the title either, I don't think, which was the publisher's idea, not mine. Life's a drag.
Oh, dear. Have you ever written fiction?
No, I've never written fiction.
Have you ever been tempted to write a ghost story, for instance?
Well, no, my wife suggested that I should write fiction, and I don't know. It just doesn't appeal to me. And I have tried once or twice, but it just doesn't come to anything. I'm much more interested in recording the true happenings of other people.
To get back to the current book, say I want to start hunting ghosts, just wake up tomorrow and think, right, this is going to be my hobby from now on. How do I start? Where, for instance, do I find places that ghosts are likely to be in?
Well, at the end of the book, I've published something that is completely unique, I believe, a ghost calendar. And there are many so-called cyclic ghosts, which are ghosts that recur in cycles, and the commonest are those that recur every year. And I've gone through the year indicating the date on which ghosts are reputed to appear at certain places. And so I think that's quite a good start. You find one that's near your home and sit up that night or that day and see whether you experience anything.
Well, the nearest to this date is the 21st of December, at the Sniper Stones near Bishop's Castle in Shropshire. All the ghosts in Britain are said to meet. All the ghosts in Britain.
Well, that's the story.
I wonder what they do, play bridge? Have a drink?
No, I'm sure. They'll probably haunt each other.
You mentioned equipment earlier. For the ghost hunter starting out, what is the absolute basic minimum equipment you need?
Oh, I think a thermometer and a notebook and a camera. I think you could go along with that. That's fine. So you give very accurate notes of the things that people tell you. Make sure that the temperature is recorded at the place where the ghost or ghostly happening occurs. And have a camera always ready, because one never knows.
Do the images of ghosts that can be seen with the eye always appear on film, or do they sometimes just not?
No, there's nothing, nothing dependable in this subject. Some things happen, sometimes they don't. Sometimes the figures that are seen appear on camera. More often, the human observer sees nothing at all, takes a photograph there. Like at Raynham Hall, which I reproduce in the book, which is absolutely remarkable. I mean, there, the Country Life sent a couple of photographers along to Raynham Hall simply to photograph the interior of this lovely old place. And when they were setting up the apparatus, one of the cameraman's assistant or the photographer's assistant said he thought he saw something on the stairs, and the photographer took this photograph, and there is what appears to be a shape walking down the stairs, which presumably is Dorothy Walpole, who's long been reputed to haunt the place. But this, you see, was taken by people who had no interest in ghosts, no knowledge of ghosts, even that there was a ghost there.
You said, though, that most ghosts appear to be solid, but in photographs, they don't. They don't come across as, if I took a photograph of you now.
That's right, yes.
Is there any explanation for that?
No explanation at all, no. Again, in that remarkable one that was taken at the Queen's House at Greenwich, there you've got a wispy, transparent figure. That is not, as ghosts are seen. But then they were not seen by the people that took the photograph. They didn't see anything at all. They were simply photographing the staircase. When the photograph was developed, there's this figure on it.
For the ghost hunter, the amateur ghost hunter, does it help to have some kind of scientific knowledge, or can anyone do it?
Well, I suppose anyone can do it, but if you have some scientific knowledge and some scientific outlook and some, you know, regulated mind, I think it helps.
Does it help to have an open mind? If you go
an open mind, yes.
If you go hunting for ghosts as a complete sceptic, you're unlikely to see one.
No, that doesn't make any difference.
It doesn't?
I don't think it makes any difference at all, no. I think if you're hidebound and, you know, there are no such things as ghosts, then if one appears, you won't see it, because there are people whose physical, mental makeup is such that they cannot accept the possibility of ghosts. Well, I mean,
that's fear, isn't it?
Well, it may be fear, it may be an excuse, yes, I don't know. But there are people like that. But I think the majority of people accept that some people do have odd experiences. And the vast majority of people who have fairly open minds and well worth doing, I think.
I'm talking to ghost hunter Peter Underwood. Your third musical choice this evening, you wanted the theme from Dr. Zhivago. Why this?
Well, this is purely a selfish memory. It's a very happy occasion when the film was first shown in London. My wife and I went up and we had a dinner with some very pleasant friends and saw the film, and it's just a very, very happy evening, and it's a nice theme, I think. Brings back memories.
Jeff Love Orchestra playing the theme from Dr. Zhivago. That's Peter Underwood's third musical choice this evening. We'll be talking again in a moment. For the serious ghost hunter like yourself, for the most part, it's a tedious process, isn't it? It requires a lot of patience, and it's mostly waiting for something that usually doesn't happen.
That's right, that's right. But when something does happen, then it's well worth all the waiting. I should say, too, that it happens most frequently when one least expects it. I've sat for hours and hours and hours and hours and hours in haunted houses, and on several occasions, when about 4 o'clock in the morning, we decided, well, nothing's going to happen here, and so we pack up the apparatus, turn everything off, and settle down for a kip. Boom, boom, boom.
And then you plug in the apparatus again.
Too late, too
late. Gracious.
Yes, yes. There was a fascinating incident in the Cotswolds, a house in the Cotswolds at Newark Park, not very long ago. We went down there, and for over 20 years, there have been stories of a rustling sound on a particular stairway. It's interesting that stairways and staircases and bedrooms are the most haunted parts of houses. And this rustling sound and the sound of whispering had been reported, and footsteps, which is the commonest of all recorded phenomena in houses, had been reported time after time. And we went down there, and of course we concentrated on this particular landing, and we sat and we sat and we sat and we sat and we sat, and then we did hear a rustling sound. And of course immediately you think it has a natural explanation. We looked everywhere, we couldn't find any explanation for it, but we had sat for a long time, and so we sat and had some refreshments, and we thought, now what should we do? And we decided to sit again at the same place with a recording apparatus running, and we thought we'd have a camera loaded with infrared film, takes photograph in darkness, pointed at the spot, and if we heard the rustling again, we'd take a photograph to see whether there's anything on it. So we sat, and 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 we sat, just nothing at all.
And you can't do anything, can you? You can't read or have a drink or whatever?
You can't make a noise at all. No. We never drink anyway on these things. Anyway.
Start seeing things after a while if you do.
Absolutely. And after, I don't know, 3 or 4 hours, we decided, well, nothing's going to happen here, and so we went down and had some sandwiches, and we thought, well, we'll just run the recording through, because we didn't take a photograph, because we hadn't heard anything, but we'd had the recording running, and we ran it through, and there are two voices on it. There's a man's voice that says, it's looking, and a woman's voice says, it's looking at us, and it's almost as if they're referring to the lens of the camera. But certainly nobody spoke. I was nearer to these other people than I am to you. Quite impossible for anyone to have done it.
What were the voices like?
They were very faint. Well, yes, they sounded, you could distinguish that one was a male and one was female. But they were a sort of, it's looking. It's looking at us.
And nobody could have tampered with the tape afterwards?
Oh, no. We simply walked down and had the sandwiches and turned it on.
Reading your book, I discovered that one of the most haunted places in Britain is the very wonderful town of Farnham.
Yes.
It everywhere there seems to be haunted. The shops, the churches, the houses. Why Farnham? I mean, I know it has quite a history, but why particularly have they centred
well,
on that?
I don't know. It's simply that I think that many places are very haunted if one takes the trouble to find out. And when we moved, we lived near Farnham, and when we moved there, I began to hear of stories of this and stories of that, and I then found that there was a police officer in the local police force who was very interested in this subject, and I got in touch with him, and we had several chats and meetings, and he said he was absolutely fascinated by the accounts of ghosts that he'd come across, and he spent ages and ages going round interviewing people who'd had experiences. And a lot of the chapter is based on John Birch's researches. And there's no doubt that Farnham is very haunted, but I think lots of other places are. York is, and indeed many other towns are, if one takes the trouble to discover them.
What about in London? Is there one particular area of London that's more susceptible to apparitions or to ghosts?
I don't think so. I did a book some years ago now on haunted London, and it seemed that, you know, I divided it up into the various areas, and they all had some wonderful ghost stories associated with them.
Other areas of the world, which you do cover briefly in the Ghost Hunter's Guide, for instance, North America.
Mm.
Now, there seem to be a lot of ghosts or a lot of incidents of the paranormal in Canada.
Yes. Well, they are simply ones that have come to my attention. I mean, again, I think there are an awful lot of stories of ghosts and hauntings in North America. There are a lot in America that have never been, the United States, that have never really been collected. And perhaps I should do a gazetteer of American ghosts.
The famous American example, of course, in the 70s was the Amityville case, which was made into a film. And a
yes.
book. But that was never substantiated as actually happening.
No, it wasn't. That's quite true. now, I think it is generally accepted by thinking people that there was very little there. But at the time, it was accepted. And very early on, we sent an investigator out there, and he came away convinced that there was really nothing really worth investigating. And subsequent exploration of the story has proved that that is so. I mean, almost any part of the story that you take, it just falls to pieces under your hand.
But the fascination that aroused all over the world, it seems that although we are, for the most part, sceptical, we actually, there's a side of us that wants to believe in ghosts.
Well, I think that's true, yes. I don't know whether it's because organized religion has collapsed to a certain extent and that mankind needs something that he can't explain in his life, I don't know. Certainly, I think there is a greater interest in ghosts and that sort of thing than used to be.
The photographic evidence of ghosts, you have several examples in the book, apparently authentic and obviously faked. In the last century, it appeared most were faked. You had full-time, let's fake a ghost photographers, most of whom made a killing, didn't they?
Yes, they did for a time. Of course, again, it's the will to believe, isn't it? It's something that you want to believe. You go and have your photograph taken, and there's your son who died years before. It's one of those things. But these were so-called induced phenomena. These were where you go and sat with a medium, and then something came out. And as you say, they were fake, quite obviously fakes. But the recent photographs that have been published, one or two which I published there, they are spontaneous ghosts. There's no question of a medium. They're simply photographs that are taken of a house or a place, and there is something on the photograph which can't be explained. I mean, the one at Greenwich, for example, I mean, it was taken. You always have to come down to the circumstances under which they were taken. I mean, this was taken by a retired Canadian clergyman who was not interested in ghosts. He was simply interested in the staircase. He took the photograph, and there was the figure. And the official photographer at the Maritime Museum was absolutely fascinated by this photograph, and he spent yards of film trying to produce a similar result with someone actually on the staircase. Doesn't come anywhere near.
As photography gets more sophisticated, has become more sophisticated, is it now well-nigh impossible to fake a picture of a ghost and have people like yourself believe it?
Well, I wouldn't say that. I addressed the Royal Photographic Society at Bath last week, and I saw some extremely interesting examples of faked photography, and there's no doubt that a competent photographer can produce some very remarkable photographs. It's all down to the circumstances under which it was taken. And, of course, as with ghosts that are seen, the important thing is who saw it, what documentary evidence, what confirmatory evidence there is.
Is the first thing you investigate when somebody, say, reports that their house is haunted or they've seen a ghost wherever, do you investigate them, first of all,
yes,
to find out about their state of mind, the kind of person they are?
That's right.
What do you look for?
It's very difficult to say, but I can only say, and it's a sort of strange thing to say, perhaps, but I can only say that I can talk to someone for 5 minutes and I can tell whether they're telling the truth or whether they're not. And they may be self-deluded. That, again, is a different thing. But it's quite interesting, and we have various ways and means of deciding whether the person is telling the truth. But then it doesn't. Then we look for other witnesses and the circumstances in which it happened and so on.
The existence of ghosts has always been a subject for a lot of scepticism. Can you see a time when the people on this planet will ever totally accept their existence, as we accept the existence of that tree over there, for instance?
Yes, I don't think there's any doubt that we shall. I mean, what, 100 years ago, people would have said that if you could see something that was happening in the other side of the world in a little box, it was absurd. But we do it now and accept it. And, I mean, no one has ever seen a wireless wave. There's no doubt that they do exist because we see the result of them.
We're coming up to Christmas, in case you'd forgotten. Apart from Dickens' famous fictional ghost, are there any ghosts particularly associated with this time of year?
I don't think there are, really, no. A couple of quick little tales, if you like. I always like the story of the man whose obituary was published in error, And on the morning it appeared, he rang up a friend and said, "Have you seen the obituary column this morning?" And there was a sort of hush from the other end, and his friend said after a moment, "From where are you speaking?" And I also like the story of the skeptic, which is a person who doesn't believe in ghosts at all. And he heard that there was a house that was so haunted that with a room that couldn't be slept in. And he said, "Oh, I'll sleep in it." And he arrived at this house on the appointed night, and he very carefully sealed the window and sealed the door and made sure there was nothing up the chimney and nothing under the bed. And satisfied nothing could possibly get in, he hopped into bed and put the light out. And a horrible little voice said close to his ear, "So now we're both locked in for the night."
Peter Underwood, thanks for being with me this evening. The Ghost Hunter's Guide is published by Blandford Press. Your final musical choice this evening, from the show that's currently impossible to get into in the West End, The Phantom of the Opera. Have you seen the show?
No, I haven't. I was hoping to, but it seemed an appropriate theme to have. And there is a haunting quality about it, which I like very much. And I'm still hoping to get into it.
This is the overture from Act 2, The Phantom of the Opera. Of the overture to Act 2 of The Phantom of the Opera, Peter Underwood's final musical choice this evening on LBC. Once again, his book, The Ghost Hunter's Guide, is published by Blandford Press.